I don't have a tag. My name is Joe. I'm proud to be a member of the Lee County Historical Society, and on behalf of the Society and of President Sue Olson, who alas is indisposed to speak this evening, I'd like to welcome you to the program, Felix Hughes, Criminal Lawyer. First, if I may, a blurb about the Sunday special on March 19th at the Keokuk, at the Miller House. It is 1800s architecture in Keokuk. Matthew Walker of Pepping, Stone, and Bach. That'll be at 2 p.m., but we'll open at 1, in case you want to find a seat.
Please turn off your cell phone.
Well, you know, imagine if this baby had gone off during a program. Thing like that would be, so let me just make sure it doesn't happen. But that's what it would have sounded. Had it gone off, that's exactly how it would have sounded.
Sure, not, it didn't go off.
Yeah, it's probably lucky about that, aren't we? Yeah. Okay. Well, it's my pleasure and privilege to introduce Duane to you tonight. And his bio, I mean, you have to read a thing like this because he has so many credentials that it's impossible to pin them all to memory. Duane is a retired English and humanities teacher who earned his BA at the University of Illinois, Urbana, and his master's degree at Yale, both in English. He has taught at Western Illinois University, Carl Sandburg College, and John Wood Community College, and served as community college administrator in Carthage and Quincy, Illinois. Currently, he's the president of the Keokuk Public Library Foundation,
Hi.
Which is how a few strings got pulled. I'm sure we got the room.
I'm going to go look for more chairs.
Oh, okay. She's
okay. He's voted off.
Are the chairs right here? You're sitting on more than one, aren't you?
This one's safe. There's somebody here.
I have more chairs coming. It'll be just a moment.
He has devoted almost 15 years to researching the Spencer murder case and the trial of Bill Young. He lives in rural Warsaw on the family farm with his wife Joyce. And now, because I don't think I've taken up enough of your time, I just had a little introduction of my own prepared. It always seems to be kind of ludicrous that I'm introducing some distinguished person to people who usually know him far better than I do. But when I first met Duane, the thing that struck me first was respect for the man. And I know that there are some people that, because of their position, will demand respect. And I know that there are some people that, because of their personality, feel they can command respect. But it seems to me that respect is too noble a beast to be ordered around. And the only way that you can get respect is to earn it, okay? Or, even better, to inspire it. And as proof of how well that can be done, it's my pleasure to introduce Duane Taylor.
Yeah. Thank you, Joseph. You can also buy respect. Very happy to be here tonight. Nice crowd. Thanks for coming out on an overcast evening. I'd like to thank a number of folks before I get started. First of all, of course, the Lee County Historical Society. And especially Jolene Kempker, who helped with marketing and apparently managed to bribe the editor of the Daily Gate City for a great placement of that little article. Great debt of thanks to Tanya Boltz, a friend of mine, patron services supervisor for the Keokuk Public Library, in charge of local history, genealogy, as well as all other kinds of patron services. She is a true gem and the heart and soul of the Keokuk Public Library, in my opinion. She is serving as my technician this evening, and my technical advisor, because I have two technical skills, and one of them is brushing my teeth. Let's give her a round of applause. here tonight come from three sources. The first is a book that came out in 1997 by James Kemm. It's a biography of Rupert Hughes, one of Felix Hughes's sons. Unknown to most, Rupert was an early Hollywood celebrity. He was a writer of silent screenplays. And he hobnobbed with everybody from Charlie Chaplin to W.C. Fields. He was an amazing kind of guy. Wrote one of the early biographies, multi-volume biographies of George Washington. Very controversial. Nobody reads it now. The Keokuk Public Library has a pretty extensive collection of his novels. Nobody reads those. they're very sentimental and dated, actually. The second source that I want to point out to everybody is a little book, like so many books that I got in my life from Courtyard Books. Carol Betts, thank you very much. My life hasn't been the same since you closed. By Francis Helenthal, called The Keokuk Connection, all about the Hughes family. There are some wonderful photographs in here. And Mr. Helenthal did a wonderful job. It was published originally in 1976. I don't know if it's still in print, but I do know the library has a copy in its Hughes file. Very useful. Other images that I'll be using tonight, as well as other information, comes from my research on the saga of the Spencer murders in 1877. Which I hope will come out in my lifetime, we shall see. All right. Felix Hughes is an interesting character. Next slide, please. He lived for many years in his favorite house. He actually owned five houses in Keokuk. This was his favorite. This is 312 North 5th Street. If you stand out on the apron just in front of the Keokuk Public Library here and look north, you'll see the front of that house jutting out into Fifth Street. It is next door to the Samuel Miller House, which is the location, the home of the Lee County Historical Society. It's been slightly renovated on the outside, but really not much. It's in great shape. He had four children that lived to adulthood. First was Greta, Howard Sr., Rupert, the guy with the mustache, and Felix Jr. Felix and Jean Hughes' children were their pride and joy, and Felix spent most of his fortune making sure that they got to do exactly what they wanted. Greta wanted to be an operatic singer, and she was sent to Europe to take singing lessons with professionals. Felix and his wife funded all of that. Felix Jr. was a contratenor and wanted to be an opera star and was sent to Europe to study and eventually became a very successful voice teacher on the West Coast. Howard Sr. was something of a minor wastrel, but he liked to tinker with mechanical things, and he tinkered away, and there's a famous story about how he bought the patent on a special drill at a bar in Texas, and took the idea, went back to Keokuk, and at the dining room table of his parents' house, designed this hard rock drill. That he very cleverly refused to sell to anybody, but would be happy to lease it to you, and consequently founded the fortune that was squandered by his only son, Howard Jr. This is the famous, and later in his life, infamous and actually quite insane, Howard Hughes Jr. And the tall man on the left is his father, Howard Sr. This is, of course, Rupert. I've given him a little introduction already. Jean Hughes, Felix's wife, was a very cultured person and insisted that her children all take piano lessons and study languages, and they all attended, as near as I can tell, Garfield School, just down the block, where the tennis courts are on Fifth Street. Next slide. Well, so many years ago that Felix Hughes was well known as a civic leader in Keokuk. He moved to Keokuk in 1880. He was appointed the Solicitor General for the Missouri-Iowa-Nebraska Railroad. A Solicitor General is a corporate lawyer who represents the company in all legal actions. So it's an important job for that particular railroad. That was a railroad that left Keokuk, went across northern Missouri, took a right turn, went up to Centerville, Iowa, and the planned idea was for it to keep on going west into Nebraska. I don't know how far they got. Later, when Jay Gould busted up the Wabash system, the Missouri, Iowa, and Nebraska became the Keokuk and Western Railroad, and Felix was appointed the president of that railroad. And he was also doing a bunch of legal work for lots of other railroads around. He was always going to Chicago, and he earned enormous fees for that. He became, later in life, judge of the Keokuk Superior Municipal Court, and he was thereafter always addressed, even by his wife, as Judge Hughes. He was mayor of Keokuk in 1894 and 1896. They still had two-year terms, just like they do now for the mayor. And in an article in the Constitution Democrat in May of 1899, Felix Hughes was actually credited with the idea of damming the Mississippi from the Iowa to the Illinois shore with one lock for boats, and also it would create hydroelectric power, an idea which became a reality 14 years later. Now, I haven't researched whether or not that is actually true or not, but that was a fairly long article. Unless the guy was lying, I think that's probably true. This is a picture of Felix from the 1885 or 86 illustrated history of Lee County. And a litho that was made from the photograph that we saw at the very beginning. Not a great deal is known about Felix's early life, unfortunately. We know he was born in 1838. His father was a farmer who eventually farmed land near Arbella, Missouri. He was not particularly well educated. He read law, but I'm not sure that he had, I know he didn't have any college. I'm assuming he had high school, but I have no idea where he went. He read law with a lawyer, as was common in those days. You didn't have to go to law school. When the Civil War broke out, he and his family were unionists, and so he joined the Union Missouri Guards, which did not, in that part of the country, see a great deal of action. In 1865, he married Jean Summerlin, and that was an interesting relationship. Felix Hughes was a unionist. Jean Summerlin was a Confederate sympathizer, as was all of her family. So Rupert used to say that he grew up thinking both sides were absolutely right. They moved to Lancaster, which is the seat of Schuyler County, Missouri, and he was admitted to the Missouri Bar in 1866. He practiced civil and criminal law. He was more or less an ordinary country lawyer. We don't know much. Let me revise that. We don't know anything about his cases except one. By 1879, he had five young children that ranged in age from 13 years to 3 years old. So he needed to earn some fees to keep bread on the table. The only case he was involved with that received enormous publicity was his last case in Missouri. After that, his career took a turn and he became a railroad lawyer completely. It was an explosive criminal case, and it's the criminal case that I've been working on because it's really a saga, an epic. I've been working on it for about the last 15 years or so. Now, I have to give you some background for you to understand Felix Hughes' role in this sensational case. And I can't emphasize enough, in an era before radio, long before TV or movies, how all-encompassing and well-known and notorious this case was. On the day the murders were discovered, about 1,000 people ended up at the Spencer farm, trampling around, looking for clues. Often what they did is they'd take their jackknives off and they'd cut off pieces of blood-stained wallpaper. They took the axe that was the murder weapon and shaved off little pieces that were blood-stained so they could keep them for souvenirs. And they trampled absolutely any subtle clues that might have been left anywhere. There was no crime scene protection whatsoever. Everybody covered it, all the newspapers, but especially the Daily Gate City and the Daily Keokuk Daily Constitution had long, long stories about it and continued to cover the story as it unwound, and it took 3 years for this case to unwind completely. In the middle of nowhere, in Clark County, Missouri, an entire farm family, two young women, two boys, their father, were killed in their sleep by blows from an axe. This happened in the early morning hours of August 3rd, 1877, just before the Keokuk Canal was opened in the middle of August of that year, near Luray, about 5 or 6 miles north. It generated two murder trials. Both were sensational. The first one involved a guy named Willis James, who was actually the brother-in-law of Lewis Spencer, who was killed, the father of the family. He was a farmhand. He was about 26 years old. He had a reputation for being kind of slow, not very witty, and yet people said he really loved those kids, and they couldn't imagine that he did it. So that was the first one. The second murder trial in 1879 was the trial of William J. Bill Young. The initial investigation was undertaken by local members of the Anti-Horse Thief Association, AHTA, and resulted in the arrest of Willis James, who discovered the deed. The Anti-Horse Thief Association is not well known these days, but immediately after the Civil War, what unscrupulous people would do, since both armies were buying horses as fast as they could, what unscrupulous people would do was steal horses from one state, take them across state lines, and sell them in the other as their own. This was becoming a big problem. And local residents, especially farmers, got together and created this. There isn't any real easy way to call it anything but what it was a vigilante society. Except they didn't hang the folks when they found them. They said, no, no. They were going to follow the strict tenets of the law, and they present them to law enforcement. Law enforcement in this era was exceedingly lax. Most sheriffs and their deputies served process, summons to come to court, or guarded the jail, and they didn't do much in terms of tracking down or investigating perpetrators of crimes. So the Anti-Horse Thief Association became very important. And eventually, by the 1920s, it became very large. There were 50,000 members in hundreds of sub-orders in five states. They were huge. Then in the 1920s, as cars began to supplant horses, it became, and law enforcement was getting much better training, eventually the Anti-Horse Thief Society went out. But it was extremely central for this particular case. Actually, the Anti-Horse Thief Association was founded by somebody named Major McKee in Lorain, Missouri itself, only 5 or 6 miles from where the murders took place. It was a matter of local pride. And so they were doing the investigating. The James trial ended in a technical acquittal, which is a very interesting story in itself, involving the Keokuk College of Physicians and Surgeons, but that's a separate story. Next slide. This is only the second time any audience has seen these images. They were found serendipitously. They were in the possession of descendants of Lewis Spencer's brother, who immigrated to Nebraska. And by a quirk of fate, he managed to get hold of them. The members of the family who held on to these ancient photographs had no idea who these people were. There's almost no doubt that these are the Spencers who were murdered. And these photographs are taken at most only months before they were murdered. On the left, on the left is Lewis Spencer, the father. He looks kind of grim, doesn't he? He got up every day to work. He was an elder of a primitive Baptist church not far from where he lived. That particular church fined and expelled their members for dancing, only they didn't call it dancing, they called it disorderly walking. It was a very strict group. His wife had died 3 or 4 years before this, and he was doing his best to raise the family by himself. This photograph shows his two boys. The one on the right is Willis, who was actually the namesake of the guy who was first arrested, namesake of his uncle. And then little Charlie, who was 7 years old when he was killed. Now, again, imagine, these are kids that were killed by blows of an axe to their head. It was an utterly heinous crime, probably as a result of a robbery. These are the girls who were killed. This is Alice. She was about 21. She had just become a school teacher like 6 months before. Slept up in the loft. She had a bedroom. She was literally a spinster. She spun wool, among other things. And over on the left is Jane. She was 17 or 18 years old, and she was the housekeeper for the family. Now, the second trial was extraordinarily interesting and complicated. This is Bill Young. This is a photograph that has never before been published. He's kind of, he just misses being handsome by about this much. He's a very hardworking guy. He was fairly wealthy. He was widely hated for his sharp business practice. If he could collect two amounts of interest on a single note, he would do that. He thought he could get away with it. He was a bully and an intimidator, and he was always willing to shuck his coat and fight. Moreover, to make things worse, he was constantly bragging and boasting. He would say, "I'm the smartest guy you've ever seen, and I can earn money faster than you any day of the week." And he would boast about everything. folks just hate. He was the kind of guy, you'd see him walking down the street, you'd go to the other side because you didn't want to meet this guy. He was a recent widower and father to five living children, and he was living at the time with a 21-year-old woman who was acting as his housekeeper. This is Laura Sprouse. It's another photograph that has never before been printed. And despite how she looks much older, I'm here to tell you, in that picture, she's about 21 years old. I think she enjoys her bills. Young was investigated and charged by a private detective that was hired by the Anti-Horse Thief Association. He used the name Frank Lane, but really, he was no more than a bounty hunter. There is a single image of Frank Lane. I didn't bring it. It is a lithograph based on a photograph that was probably taken in Kansas City. It was published on page one of the Keokuk Daily Constitution on May 3rd, 1879. And like all early lithographs, you really can't tell much, except that he has this fierce look in his eye. Lawyers for the prosecution for this case, first was Ben Turner, who was the Clark County prosecutor elected by the people, and the second was Felix Hughes. Felix Hughes was hired by the Anti-Horse Thief Association because the county prosecutor really didn't want to prosecute Bill Young at the beginning. There wasn't enough evidence. He wasn't convinced. And there was a tussle, and finally Frank Lane said, okay, you don't want to prosecute this guy, we'll hire our own guy and do our own prosecution, at which point Ben Turner, who was a pretty good prosecuting attorney and very ambitious, he wanted to be a judge, saw the way the political wind was going to be blowing, and he said, well, I'll work something out with Mr. Hughes. And so Felix Hughes was on the prosecution side with Ben Turner. There is every reason to believe, as I've come to believe, that Young was framed by the private detective for the murders with the connivance of the housekeeper, Laura Sprouse. Without Laura's testimony, there would not have been a case. Laura thought that Bill, who had taken a trip to Ohio late in 1878, around Christmas time, that Bill had married somebody in Ohio, where his people had come from. Laura was wrong, but he did get engaged, and Laura felt she was betrayed by him, and she was going to get even. So, Young is arrested in February of 1878 by Frank Lane. A little background about legal process in criminal cases. What happens first is there's a sworn complaint. Frank Lane, the detective, is the one who swore out the complaint. He went to Justice of the Peace in Luray, who was a Bill Young hater, and got him to sign off on the complaint. After that, there has to be a preliminary examination, which can be waived by the person who's accused, in front of a justice of the peace or judge, and after that, there is a formal indictment, a formal charge of a crime, and after that, there's a trial. In basic outline, this is what happens in a criminal trial, certainly in a capital case. The preliminary examination of Bill Young felt so much like a trial that you would have sworn you were at a trial. But it wasn't. It was a preliminary examination. By happenstance, the transcript for that preliminary examination has survived for 140 years. We found it by accident. It was misfiled in a bunch of old files kept in cardboard boxes in the basement of the old Clark County courthouse. Moldering. Why we ever found it, I don't know. It is 330 pages long. Preliminary examination for Bill Young went on for more than 2 weeks. It featured witnesses for both sides. And we're not talking about one or two. We're talking about 15, 20 witnesses. And it was convened in Lorain, Missouri, which was unfortunate because all of Bill's enemies, of course, lived in Lorain. And so there was this constant crowd outside the little tiny doctor's office that was being used as a courtroom there, and they were all against Bill Young. Why was a doctor's office being used that was maybe 15 by 20 feet square? It was used because originally they wanted to use the Oddfellows Hall. Very first day of the trial, there were so many people of the preliminary examination, there were so many people that wanted to get in, the floor of the Oddfellows Hall broke. All of a sudden people are canting over there, and it happened not once, but several different times. So the next day, the justices got together and said, well, we gotta find someplace, and we really don't want to move it to the First Methodist Church. Doesn't seem quite appropriate. So they chose this little doctor's consulting room. And it was tiny, but it was enough. Two justices could be there, the lawyers could be there, and they all brought in chairs and stuff, and one witness at a time, but it was cramped. And what's worse, on the back wall behind the justices was an articulated human skeleton. It was used by the doctor, of course, but it kind of put a grim kind of shadow on the proceedings from Bill Young's point of view. The two justices of the peace, this was only a few years after the end of the Civil War, 1914. One was a Union guy who'd been wounded twice and captured by the Confederates. And one was a Confederate sympathizer. Now it's interesting, they had two justices of the peace. One never said a word. He sat up there, listened, signed stuff, never said anything. The preliminary examination was really presided over by Justice Reynolds, who was the Union sympathizer. Put yourself in the place of the Justice of the Peace who is trying to preside at this preliminary examination. He looks out in this small room, and who does he see? He sees the county prosecutor. Justices of the peace did not know the law all that well. So he looks out there and he sees the chief law enforcement guy for the entire county sitting there. And wrangles between the lawyers, quarrels on motions. The justice always favored the prosecution because there was the county prosecutor. It drove Bill Young's lawyer up a wall, and it was blatantly unfair. Hughes' role in this preliminary examination, because he was there, is not particularly well known. Yes, there is a transcript. Yes, it is 330 pages long, but the guy who was taking the notes in longhand was a newly minted lawyer named John M. Wood. No relation to the John Woods down in Quincy at all, but in later life, he became a judge down in St. Louis and was very well known and was elected, at least for one term, as Missouri's Attorney General. The only man in Clark County ever to hold state elected office. So he's the transcript guy, and he's got a pen, and he's trying to write as fast as he can. And he's kind of telegraphic about what he's writing. And so we don't really know who was asking the questions at any given time. Was it Ben Turner, the county prosecutor, or was it Felix Hughes? There certainly was some questioning and cross-examining of witnesses that Felix Hughes did. And again, as I said before, the justices consistently ruled against the motions by Young's lawyer, and after more than 2 weeks, Young was, they found cause to bind him over for indictment, the next step in the legal process. And so he was house arrest, taken over to Keokuk, and lodged in the Keokuk jail. County jails in this era of history were horrible places. And among the most horrible was the Clark County Jail in the basement of the courthouse in Keokuk, even though that courthouse was only 4 or 5 years old. It was a damp basement, had a dirt floor. It had what was called a soil box for the prisoners down there in the cell. The soil box wasn't cleaned out very often. It stunk. It was unhealthy. And there, Bill Young sat for 6 months of his life, doing the best he could down there under those conditions. Now, this is a very important point, and it's one that took me a long time to ferret out because almost no evidence exists, very little, but there's enough in the record that you can pick it up. Bill Young had a clandestine correspondence in April and May of 1879 while he was in jail with his housekeeper. There was at least one letter from Young to her while he was in jail and one from the housekeeper to Young. The housekeeper's letter, although it no longer exists, probably pretty much admitted that Young was framed. How do we know this? Young, in a moment of great excitement when he thought he was about ready to be hanged while he was still in jail, admitted that this letter existed at one time. So he has this letter in hand. July 1879, Young disputes his lawyer's fee and fires him. He figures the letter from the housekeeper is his get out of jail free card. He doesn't need a lawyer. Lawyers cost money. Bill didn't want to spend any money. So with this letter in hand, he figured he could conduct his own defense. And if there are lawyers in here, you may understand how bad an idea that is. And then, the private detective, who's actually a bounty hunter, a very clever man, who read a lot of Pinkerton's little fictional books on private detectives, figured out a way to get a confederate of his into the jail. Franklin comes down the steps to the basement jail and creates a ruckus with Bill Young and distracts his attention. And his confederate in the same cell steals the letter. And eventually, the confederate gets let go. So, but Bill didn't find out that it was gone for a while, and in the meantime, he had fired his lawyer. So, as soon as Bill realizes that the letter is gone, he becomes desperate. He needs a new lawyer. He was too proud to go back to the people he had, to the lawyers he originally had, Matlock and Hiller in Keokuk. And he starts flailing around. He writes to Daniel F. Miller in Keokuk, who's probably the best, at that time, the best lawyer in Keokuk, trying to get him on as defense counsel. Daniel Miller says, no way, not unless you rehire Matlock. Bill couldn't do that, he was too proud. So he writes another letter to H.H. Trimble, a guy in southern Iowa who at that time was running for governor and had a good reputation as a lawyer. Mr. Trimble, would you represent me? And Trimble writes back and says, no, I'm kind of busy trying to be governor. Don't have time for that. So finally, somehow, never revealed, he gets a hold of the firm of Baker and Drake. Now, law firms in the old days were partnerships that just kind of happened. Lincoln was involved in a dozen different partnerships. And this was one of those partnership deals that came together for this particular case. Andrew Baker is from Centerville, Iowa. He had a college education at the institution which would become Iowa Wesleyan University. He practiced law in Clarinda, I believe, maybe Winterset. And he was, interestingly, before he went to Iowa, he used to live in Lancaster, Missouri. He was elected to the Missouri State Legislature, and he was elected to be Missouri's Attorney General. Now, at the time of the trial, he is serving as general counsel for the Missouri, Iowa, and Nebraska Railroad. The general counsel is the lawyer that writes hurdle over all the cases. He may not appear in court for specific cases, but he writes hurdle over all of them. Later, he gets elected Attorney General of Iowa, and as far as I know, this is the only instance in American history where an Attorney General from one state is elected the Attorney General of another state. Maybe I'm wrong, but I haven't come across it. So that's Andrew J. Baker, and I can let you know, really, he's my hero. He is an amazing lawyer, very clever. Next slide. This is his brother-in-law, Francis M. Drake. He is founder and president of the Missouri, Iowa, Nebraska Railroad. He is a bank president. He is a huge man who went to California in the Gold Rush days not once, but twice overland and came back. He always felt bad that he didn't have much of an education. When he came back a second time from California, he read law. And he was a self-taught lawyer, and he was a shrewd businessman. Later in the 1890s, he was elected governor of Iowa, and because of his bequest, Drake University is named after him, because of his great respect for education. If I remember correctly, Frank Drake married Andy Baker's sister, which is how they got to be brothers in law. Given the close business connection between Baker and Drake and Hughes, you'll remember that Hughes was the local attorney in charge of MINN litigation in northern Missouri. It is exceedingly probable that Felix Hughes was instrumental in Young's hiring of Baker and Drake. Now think about that. Think about how odd that is. Hughes was a prosecutor. He was trying to nail Bill Young for the murder of the Spencers. And instead, clandestinely and without permission, he actually finds what's probably the best legal team in three states to work against his interests as prosecutor, to defend Bill Young. Now, why would he do that? That's right. Here's my best guess. Having sat through and helped conduct Young's preliminary examination, Hughes may have thought that Young was being framed by the Spencer murders. I mean, Frank Lane, the private detective, was clever and he was shrewd and he wore nice clothes. As a matter of fact, at one point, Frank Lane said he could run any man in Clark County with a bar of soap. Now that puzzled me for a long time, and I think what he meant was all he had to do was take a bath and dress up, and everybody in Clark County had a lot of respect for him. This was a clean guy. We'll do what he says. And I think, despite Franklin's shrewdness, I think that it was pretty clear to any lawyer who knew anything that this was a setup job. This was a fraud. It was all too convenient. And yet, here's the interesting part. Felix Hughes was still on retainer with the Anti-Horse Thief Association for the prosecution of Bill Young, and he needed the money. This is a guy that's got five young kids at home. He's got to put meat on the table. So his role was really delicate. Now we're getting into the trial itself. And again, this is not something that happened in obscurity. This was well reported in Daily Gate City. It was well reported in the Daily Constitution, both big papers in Keokuk. It was reported in all the smaller weekly papers around. It was reported in the Cahokia paper, which thought so much about this issue that they installed a steam press, particularly to get every piece of the trial out to their subscribers. So during the trial, opens, it's October 1879. Hughes law partner, a quiet, unassuming, kind of colorless, you'd think he was a clerk guy, makes the opening statement for the prosecution, a very odd choice. Because what he does is, and this guy's name is James Raley, what he does is get up and lay out exactly what the prosecution was going to prove. I mean, in detail. About 15 or 20 minutes into it, so much detail was being presented, and there were so many witnesses in the audience, the judge stopped everything and said, "Excuse me, Mr. Raley, I had no idea that your opening statement was going to be so detailed," and he cleared the courtroom. So 150 people, at least, triumphed out of the courtroom and went down, and then Raley completed his remarks. It was a very odd opening for that. The opening for the defense was made by Andy Baker, and it was superb. Hughes' role in this trial was muted. We do have a better record of what he did, what he was talking, what he was cross-examining, what he was questioning witnesses. But mostly, it was the county prosecutor who was doing the work. Hughes didn't do a great deal. Once, when Hughes conducted a cross-examination of a defense witness, he nearly got into a physical fight with a defense lawyer, and both attorneys were fined. They got into this argument, "Well, you've got the witness under your control." And the guy says, "It's a lie. I do not." "Well, yes, you do. What are you going to do about it?" And the judge said, "No, you'll both contribute $5 to the school fund and be fined for contempt," because of it. It's a really no-nonsense judge. Another guy I really admire, his name is John Anderson. Hughes played the smallest role he could in the prosecution, which would make sense if he actually thought Young was innocent. But there's more. Closing speeches at Young's trial. In the 19th century, closing speeches could sway a jury, even more than arguments could. And they were these speeches on which the lawyers would work sometimes for weeks to get it right. They would be emotional appeals that would include even shouting and ranting. And this was certainly the standard in the early 19th century. The later 19th century lawyers were getting away from this kind of emotionalism. Hughes's closing argument to the jury was spectacularly poor. Now remember, this is a lawyer that people liked. This is a lawyer that thought he had done a really good job before, so they hired him. but it was spectacularly poor. There were 7 lawyers, there are 7 speeches, and I've analyzed each one lots of times, because all were reported in one way or another in the Keokuk papers. And by the way, the historical collections that Tanya rides herd over have every one of those on microphone. We became close friends when I was basically livid and analyzing this stuff. So what we have really is forensic drama. But arguments, that is, reasoning from evidence, must also be given. Hughes' arguments were shot full of fallacies. Before I get to that, let me give you some examples of his emotionalism, his emotional appeals to the 12 good men and true who were serving on the jury. Hughes' speech to the jury followed that of a defense lawyer from Ohio that had been hired by Bill Young's sister when he was so desperate. And the guy from Ohio was not a very good lawyer, and he lived most of the time inside a bottle. And he had that kind of reputation. Yet, as a lawyer, he wasn't so bad. So anyway, Joe Kaufman gives his speech, and then it's Hughes' turn. Hughes gets up. And here's what he says. I am a man of the neighboring county, a man of your own state, who feels as you feel, who sympathizes as you sympathize, and who desires as much as you do to ferret out this mysterious murder. The blood of these innocent girls, of this father and his sons, cries out to the hills and calls upon everyone to bring the murderer to justice. Do not think only of the defendant's tears and those of his young daughter sitting on his lap. At this time, Young's family had come in, and his youngest daughter, who was about 7 years old, climbed up on his father's lap. Bill Young was very emotional, very sentimental. Of course, he immediately starts weeping, and so does the little girl. So you're confronted with the defendant sitting close to the back of the room with his baby on his lap. Do not think only of the defendant's tears and those of his young daughter sitting on Young's lap. Where is the child who weeps for Lewis Spencer? Where are the tears of a father for murdered Alice and Jane and Willis and Charlie? Perhaps they look down from the battlements of heaven to see whether or not William J. Young is the murderer of their family. And you might think I'm overly dramatic. I'm sure Chuck thinks I am. But I can't emphasize that that's probably the beauty from what the original is. I mean, Hughes had a reputation as a bombastic speaker, a bombastic lawyer, a member of the bombastic school of law. You know, even in old age, when he was in the courtroom and he had to lean on a stick, he would use the stick to point to people and bang it on the table. Dangerous guy. Here's another example of his emotionalism. And the background of this is that Bill Young, who was always boasting, right after the Spencer murders, and when guys were talking about what had gone on, Bill would say, oh, really? You just need to ask me who the murderer is. I'm the best investigator you've ever seen, and I'll be able to put my hands on him. And if once the reward gets large enough, I'll be able to do that. And of course, all of that is repeated, of course, in his trial. Well, you had to know. And this is what Hughes said. Gentlemen, take this man, this innocent lamb, and when you find a man who can shut up in his breast that terrible secret of that horrible deed for 2 years, and never give it up because money enough was not offered. Find me a man base enough to do this, and you will find a man mean enough to commit this frightful murder. How long should the dark cloud hover over the people of this county? How long should the blood of those innocent children remain unavenged in order that a money reward reward may grow large enough to satisfy the avarice of this innocent, this high-minded man, gentleman. None less than a villain could hesitate in such a case. And finally, there is this, which I just couldn't afford to omit. When Hughes said, "Young went out there and beat out the brains of five human beings as if he were beating the brains out of a pig." Now, if this isn't deliberately constructed to engage your emotions, I don't know what is. I'm not saying that only Hughes used such emotionalism in his speech. That's not true. Everybody did, but not to the extent that Hughes used it in his speech. It's peppered with it, and it's amazing to read. It was interesting to me to find out that one of the papers, one of the writers for the paper, said that Hughes' speech on that day was one of the most convincing. But I think the judge was kind of disgusted with Hughes. He stopped him at 4 o'clock in the afternoon when Hughes was about half done and said, "You know, I think I need some supper." Which was a terrible thing for Hughes, because here he was working up the jury into this froth. And then he had to say, the judge, who didn't like Hughes at all and treated him just the side of contempt, had to start all over. We'd start all over the next day. Well, the county prosecutor got to the judge. They knew each other very well. And they said, "Look, don't hold this. You know, let's meet after supper and we'll finish up Hughes' speech and we'll be okay." And the judge agreed. But only one paper reported the last half of Hughes' speech. Everybody else got on the train and went back to Keokuk. So only one paper got the end of that speech. So, Hughes' arguments were shot full of fallacies. It was amazing for me to discover this. Hughes asked the jury to look at the crates of evidence that were sitting prominently on the prosecution's table, and he said, "Is all this evidence simply perjury, as the defense says? Don't you know that if a man swears falsely in a capital case, he is as guilty as the man who was charged? Don't you think that all our witnesses knew this? Are the prosecutors all villains and murderers?" Now, that is a logical argumentation, a fallacy called an argument by extension. It's a logical fallacy. It's no argument. Here's another example. He kind of put together a syllogism, and it goes like this. Someone who knew how to use an axe killed the Spencers. A farmer knows how to use an axe. Bill Young is a farmer, therefore Bill Young killed him. I mean, it's amazing. This is supposed to be very high power. Why is he doing this? It's a faulty syllogism. It does not necessarily follow that Young killed the Spencers just because he knew how to use an axe. Abraham Lincoln knew how to use an axe too. Lucky for him, he was already dead. Here's a final example of a fallacious argument used by Hughes. There was a terrific dispute during the trial about a trip that Bill was said to have made through the Spencer farm, which the prosecution attempted to prove did in fact happen so that Young could reconnoiter the Spencer place. Take a look around. The defense denied it hard, bringing many witnesses and even the county surveyor to suggest that there wasn't enough time for Young to have made the trip. And here's what Hughes said to the jury. No one for the defense ever swore that the trip was impossible. They dared not do it. And then he proclaimed in his very loudest voice, "I say that he could do it because he did do it." Now, I don't know how many of you encountered logical fallacies when you were in college. I used to teach them many years ago when I was but a little child. And Jolene wasn't even born yet. This is one of the most perfect examples I've ever encountered of what's called in logic the fallacy of begging the question. We all use it wrong these days. When we say begging the question, what we really mean is, boy, that particular statement means that I have to ask this question. It demands that the that's not what the petitio principio means. Begging the question means that you assume as true the very thing that you're trying and that has to be proven. It's one of the classic fallacies, and it's no kind of argument at all. Next one. My conclusion is, I'm working hard. My wife informed me that if I go over an hour, she will feign death. So I'm keeping it up. The evidence suggests that Felix Hughes was doing his best to convince his employers, the Anti-Horse Thieves Association, that he was trying to secure Young's conviction and earn his fee. Hughes was at the same time trying his best to ensure that Young was not convicted because Hughes thought the whole case was a frame-up, which is in fact my belief as well. Thus, we may admire his skill at attempting to walk the tightrope of professional ambiguity, desiring to earn a fee without helping much, if at all, to convict a man that he thought innocent. And I think that's an amazing insight into Felix Hughes. Next slide. Final results for Mr. Hughes. Hughes was rewarded for his efforts by both sides. Seriously, it was the most amazing thing. First of all, Francis Drake, the president of the railroad, appointed him solicitor general for the Missouri, Iowa, and Nebraska. This was a steady job. It came with a steady income. He didn't have to live in a cottage in Lancaster, Missouri anymore. He moved to Keokuk, where five railroads, it was a railroad terminus, came together, and he bought that beautiful brick house still standing on Fifth Street just a block away from here. And that it's like a door in his career and his professional life opened at that point. And yet, the Anti-Horse Thief Society hired Hughes again to defend the private detective bounty hunter who led the lynch mob which hanged Bill Young 3 days after the jury acquitted. And got him off by saying that a provision in Missouri's Constitution was outdated and superseded by the new Constitution of 1875. Supreme Court heard the case, Missouri heard the case and said, you're absolutely right. This is unconstitutional. You were indicted in another county from which the crime was alleged to take place. That is no longer acceptable. All crimes are assumed to be local. Therefore, we're going to have to quash the indictment. And they let him out of jail. Promptly disappeared. The only real winner in the Spencer murder case lasted for 3 years, various permutations. The only real winner was Felix Hughes. Next slide. Hughes died in 1926, his wife in 1928. In his declining years, his sons, Rupert and Felix, were living in California, helped them. Felix and Jean built their own home or bought their own home there and eventually moved in with Felix. 1931, after the parents had died, Felix and Rupert, that is Felix Jr. and Rupert, reinterred the bodies of their parents in Oakland Cemetery in Keokuk, Iowa, where they commissioned this beautiful stone, kind of in an Art Nouveau style from the 1930s. I think it's gorgeous. It's still in Oakland Cemetery. It's quite near the entrance to the National Cemetery. So Judge Hughes and his wife and stillborn child and a son named Reginald, who died of tuberculosis when he was 5 years old in Keokuk, and another daughter who lived very long, are all buried at that place. This is an amazing guy. This is part of Keokuk's heritage. And although we don't know much about other cases that Felix was involved with in Missouri, we know a great deal about this one. Thank you very much for your attention. Questions? Yes, sir.
The house up here on North Fifth, I was always under the assumption he had another house up on 10th and Grand.
He did. That was his wife's house. Judge Hughes. Judge Hughes, in his later years, and well, even when he was a middle-aged man, had a hearing problem. Was increasingly hard of hearing. That is a trait that he passed on to his son Howard Sr., his son Rupert, who in the 1930s wore a very early hearing aid with a great big battery and was a poster boy for the Hard of Hearing Association. And it passed on to the infamous Howard Jr., who had a great deal of trouble in any kind of social party because with all the commotion, you couldn't hear anybody. And so it accentuated his natural shyness. So, the point of all of this is that in later life, Felix and his wife Jean would often argue, and because Judge Hughes was hard of hearing, their arguments were loud, and the neighbors complained. And finally, relations got so deteriorated that Howard Jr. bought his mother her own house that's still standing on Grand Avenue. That was not the only house. There was another house that Felix and Jean lived in while he was mayor, and that I believe is on Fulton. And there were two other houses that he owned that he might have had in his records. Other questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah, the grave, the Hughes plot there is close to my wife's grandparents, and a few times a year, we go out there quite a bit, but there's not always, but generally there's flowers or something on that grave. Are there any relatives in close around here? Somebody is doing it, I don't know.
There are cousins in Missouri, second and third cousins. There are Hughes cousins in Missouri that are tried to be part of the general settlement of Howard Jr.'s estate.
Oh,
with millions of dollars at stake, in a case that went on for a long time. There were relatives on Gene Summerlin Hughes's side also.
Okay.
So there's somebody around
who's doing that.
So who was the murderer?
You'll have to buy the book. It is currently under consideration at the University of Missouri Press.
Yay!
I'm trying to talk him into doing a book talk. I'm trying.
You talk about cold cases. This is 140 cold. And
wasn't much physical evidence to begin with. There is today no physical evidence. Even the axe head has disappeared. The house was bulldozed during the 40s. There was a pile of sticks where the Spencers, where the bulldozer pushed over the log cabin because it was really a deteriorating house when it first took place. And of course, nobody wanted to live there. But there are some suggestive and circumstantial things that lead me to a particular
point. What happened in the first trial? Or is that, did you mention?
I will sketch it in for you. The first trial, Willis James was one of these guys who had almost no affect in his face. Mm-hmm. When he discovered the bodies, he was a little excited, but after he notified some neighbors, he had this face. And everybody thought, well, that's peculiar. He should be wailing, he should be crying and all of that. So they looked at him very closely. At one point, took him out in the brush, had him stripped to see if there was blood on him. They found a very bad boil, bleeding carbuncle. They also found spots of blood on some of his overalls and on his shirt, and eventually they found a spray. It looked like a spray of blood on the underside of his head. And they thought, well, that's an artery coming up, spraying under the brim of his hat. So they came to Keokuk and got a professor from the Keokuk College of Physicians and Surgeons who had just taken possession of a very powerful microscope. He really wanted to be known as a medical expert because there was a colleague of his on the faculty who had a powerful microscope, and he was known as a medical expert, and Dr. Carpenter really wanted to get into some of that action and fame. And so, you know, he looked and he did the primitive tests that were available in 1877 on the little tiny scraps of material that they had taken from Willis James. And he told the prosecution, I can prove absolutely that this is human blood. And the defense hired their own medical expert, and the defense said, which happened to be his rival, who had the other microscope, and the defense said, I don't think so. And actually, the defense professor at the medical college convinced the prosecution's medical expert that really you couldn't prove, A, that it was human blood. Mm-hmm. You couldn't prove, B, that it was even mammal blood. And C, you couldn't prove that it was Spencer's. None of that would be possible for another 20, 22 years until the early 1900s. And consequently, at the 11th hour of the trial, the lawyers got a note, and the note said, neither of us are going to appear. And the prosecutor, of course, dropped a load in his pants at that point, and eventually filed noli prosequi. I will not prosecute as a result of that, because the judge had made it very clear. I need testimony from a medical expert to tell me this is blood. And the county prosecutor, who had been a student of the judge's, knew exactly that old Anderson knew exactly what he was talking about, and he wasn't going to pull any punches, and he dropped out. And that's how the first trial ended. There are people today who believe that Willis James is the murderer. I do not. Mm-hmm. He's a nice guy. Peculiar, but a nice guy. Yes, sir?
Was Howard Hughes born here in Keokuk? Because he was baptized right here at St. John's?
He was baptized at St. John's. He was born in Houston.
Okay.
That's where Howard Sr. migrated to, because that's where the money was. That's where he founded Hughes Tool, and that's where he met his wife, Aline Gunn.
Did he just come back to be baptized here? Or
yes, because of the Hughes connection with his father. He did come back a couple of other times when he was younger, and came back once with a really flashy car and scared some people in Keokuk. But there was a huge rupture between Howard Jr. and the rest of the Hughes men. Rupert didn't like his attitude, and he showed up at his grandparents' place in California. They were very old. They were distraught over the death of their eldest son. And Howard Hughes just didn't think it was all that important. Didn't talk about building a memorial for his father. Didn't try very much to comfort his grandparents in their loss. And Rupert wrote in a letter that burned part of his skin off. And that was the last time that Howard Jr. had much to do with Rupert or with the Hughes side.
What happened to Howard Sr.?
Howard Sr. died of a heart attack when he was 55 and was holding a meeting at Hughes Tool. He just flung over on the table.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Have you sold your movie rights yet?
No. This would make an amazing film.
I'll give you $100.
Thank you, Chuck. I may wait for a better offer. So,
how old was Mr. Spencer, the father?
46.
But what leads you to think that what did you say, that the housemaid conspired with the
Sprouse?
Sprouse conspired with the bounty hunter?
Yes. The first, number one, the bounty hunter spirited her away. She was staying with the young children when Bill was in Ohio. He was the one who probably convinced her that Bill had gotten married to some young thing in Ohio, and convinced her enough that he gave a sleeping draft to the children. She gave a sleeping draft to the children, and he took her in a sleigh to a cousin of his, of the bounty hunter, and a week later, after some tutoring, she comes up with this complaint, this statement, that is later augmented. Mm-hmm. He keeps on adding to it and adding to it, and Andy Baker at one point says, this statement from Laura just grows as it needs to. And in fact, it did. So I'm absolutely. Yes, sir.
You didn't portray Howard Hughes too much at all in this, but yet you go out to where the spruce goose is, he can walk on water out there.
Well, that's California. When we saw it, it was in Long Beach. Yeah. And toured it, and I was much impressed.
It's something that men built now.
They moved it. He was a good engineer until he went crazy.
Well, they don't show that part.
No, they don't. He was involved in 4 aircraft crashes when he was a test pilot, testing his own designs. And the last one was for a dual engine and two-tailed plane. One of the propellers started going the wrong way. He couldn't control it. He wanted to land it on a golf course. He couldn't make it. He instead plowed into 3 houses in the Los Angeles area, and frankly, he should have died. He had multiple breaks, of course, head injuries. He was in the hospital for more than 2 months, and he became much honored after that.
He made a good movie.
If that was possible.
Pardon me?
He made a good movie.
Yeah.
But he was.
Hell's Angels?
No.
Oh, you mean The Aviator?
No. Jane Russell.
Jane Russell. You mean The Girl?
Oh, The Outlaws. Jane. he got into a lot of trouble for that movie. He argued against the censors for years before it was released. But Hell's Angels was actually pretty good. It's one of the best, one of the very first, maybe the first aerial combat movie. When he first released it, it was silent, but it took him so long to create it that silent had gone to sound, and he had to reshoot it with sound. And he's credited with discovering the great female star, Jean Harlow. And he's credited with saying, you know, Miss Harlow, you'd look so much nicer if you were a platinum blonde.
Mm-hmm.
And she did. Sir?
One more question. After Nick acquitted him, did he go back to LeGray and then they hung him down there, or was he still in Cahokia?
When he was acquitted, first thing he did was go out in Cahokia and buy himself a bath and a haircut. And he cut his beard, the same kind of beard that Andy Baker had, because Andy Baker had really freed him. And he contacted his fiancée from Ohio, because he really did go out there and get a fiancée, a young woman, and contacted her, and they got married the day after he was released. And they honeymooned in Keokuk, Iowa, at the lovely Patterson Brothers Hotel, which stood on the corner of 3rd and Johnson for many years. And they had a two, three-day honeymoon there. And of course, you gotta know Bill. He's on the streets of Keokuk bragging and boasting that he beat everybody. He's better than everybody. And you know, I'm gonna go after those guys that persecuted me. So he gets on the train to go to Cahokia. And one of his brothers and a couple of friends find the train in Alexandria and in Clark City, and they get on the train and they say, Bill, don't go home. Bill, they're out to get you. Bill, there's a whole mob, and they're mounted. Don't do this. And Bill says, look, I got free once ago. I am not going to be scared away from my home. This is where I live. I'm going to do it. So he stays on the train. But the further the train gets down the line, the closer it gets to LeRae, and his farm was about a mile south of LeRae, the more worried he gets. And he says to one person, you know, I think maybe I'll just go on to Centerville. But he doesn't. Train stops at LeRae, he gets out and looks around. There is nobody there. Perfectly quiet, the wagon is kind of crossing.
Uh-huh.
Nothing going on. So he says to his wife, Lydia, let's go. His son is waiting for him with the wagon. They go out to the farm, and the friends have prepared a welcome home dinner, and they eat, and it's all wonderful, until about 11:30 in the morning, when the first elements of the mob arrive by horseback. Followed the train. And so he was in LeRae. He was besieged. The mob was armed. They wanted him to confess to the murder of the Spencers, and he just wouldn't do it. I didn't do it. The law says I didn't do it. I wouldn't have harmed those girls. I wouldn't have harmed those little kids. Look, I got a family. I wouldn't have done it. They didn't care. The mob was led by Frank Lane, the private detective, whose pride would not let him rest. His reputation was on the line, and by God, he was going to do something about it. So he was in charge, and Billy Young is eventually wounded and is dragged downstairs by his heels and hanged from his own pasture gate. I'm telling you, this story is amazing.
Well, most of the mob, presumably the
Who's speaking, please?
Most of the mob, presumably the Anti-Horse Theft Association, or friends that are people that this guy...
That's an interesting question, Mike. they were, yes, Frank Lane's, the detective's close associates in the array, and he he had a group of maybe a dozen. They were also very bad men from the surrounding states. So there were some from Van Buren County, Iowa. There were some from Hancock County, Illinois. And there were some from further afield. Nobody knew. These were grim-faced bad guys. And those are the guys that Franklin associated with. And they were among the major players. But Franklin's friends, too, were there. And of course, everybody, Lorraine emptied out. Because there were gunshots out in Young's, we better go out and see what's going on. And there's always a crowd, of course.
Just one more question. I know it's difficult to answer, but with 300 pages of questioning of I don't know how many witnesses, did anything kind of come forward with any, out of all the speculation and all of the, that, hey, this might have been a motive, this might have been the person, this might have, did anything like that come forward?
The motive was always assumed to be a robbery gone bad, and that the Spencers were killed because they were potential witnesses, all of them. Lewis Spencer was a school district treasurer, and in those days, in the state of Missouri, a certain amount of money would come to the treasurer. And then the treasurer would use it to dispense, to pay the teachers, and to buy supplies and that kind of thing. That had just happened. And somehow, whoever did the deed, somehow knew about it. And so, when the Spencer's estate was settled, $870-some went to the county because that was the amount of school money he had received and was missing. In the 1920s, somebody was plowing up a pasture south of the Spencer place, and they managed to pull out of the ground the old red wallet, red leather wallet that had belonged to Lewis Spencer. And it included inside a single half dime. Picked it up, took the money out, threw it out.
Duane, I think your wife has started to.